Welcome, children, to the Silver Scream Fiends podcast. Prepare yourself for some killer kino, some spooky cinema, and plenty of tales of terror. Relax, grab a drink, make yourself at home, and listen to another evil episode. And hopefully, you'll make it out alive.
Alrighty, well, without further ado, welcome back to the Silver Scream Fiends podcast.
Ooh.
I'm your host, Sam. I'm rebranding.
Okay.
I'm Sam. That's Blake. He can't introduce himself anymore.
No.
He's under contract.
Can't be trusted.
He can't be trusted. And we have back on the show a very special guest, a dear friend, the co-host of a YouTube gaming show, SUBPARCADE, who was here last, oh my god, was that 2 years ago for the Superbad episode? I think
was it? It feels like it was 5 years ago.
I know, right? Anyway, well, we have Laynee here.
Hello.
And the reason we have her on is because today's episode is going to be based entirely around Scream, and she is a Scream aficionado.
Oh god, that's a lot of pressure.
Yeah, no, so why don't you just go through every plot line for us? No. But so the reason I want to do this is because I have been a fan of the series, but I'd only really seen the first one and then clips of the second one. And then once Laynee and I became good friends, she started bringing up more and more. And it wasn't until last year that I sat down and watched the second Scream all the way through, which I thought was phenomenal. And which is why this time around, I watched 3 and 4 finally.
Yeah.
And we got a fifth one coming out next year.
Yep.
Which I think, did the trailer drop already?
No, they're teasing it.
Well, they're teasing it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. They're making a ghost face emoji. to wet people's whistles.
It's wetting me somewhere for sure.
Yeah. So I thought let's do this episode on Scream and see where it takes us. But before that, we'll do a little bit of housekeeping. We're doing our killer kino watch parties this month, which will be every Wednesday, and I don't know when the hell I post this one, but tomorrow, which is October 6th, will be Brain Damage. But obviously, like, I posted the schedule up, and I'll post more links like when this goes live for the future ones. Anyway, other than that, what have you guys recently watched?
Do you want to go first, or should I?
Why don't you go first?
Okay. I've been watching a lot of horror movies, but I did watch Cats before that.
I also
very scary.
Cats. I watched Cats.
Yeah,
that was fun.
That was an experience.
Honestly, 10 out of 10. Fucking loved it.
I
it was an experience for sure. But I've watched Gremlins for the very first time, and I had a good time with that. Fuck, what else did I watch? Willy's Wonderland, that Ooh. Nick Cage movie.
Yeah, yeah.
I've been meaning to watch that.
You definitely need to. It's very fun. Apostle, it's on Netflix. It's about like cults.
Oh, that movie's good.
Yeah, it was good. I liked it. It was fun. And there's another one that's escaping me. Oh, The Visit. I watched that.
Shamalama Ding Dong.
Yeah. It was fun. Actually, the twist made me want to. I was really scared. I was like, ah! So that was good.
That was how long ago was that movie?
Was like 2016?
Are you 15?
16, 15? 16? I don't know. I have no idea. It's a newer-ish one.
Yeah. Yeah, I fell off from his work, to be completely honest. But I should give it a shot.
I go to the ones that I think look fun. And I base it off that.
Yeah, that's fair.
So. The Visit's pretty good. It's worth watching if you're like unsure of his more recent movies. That one's a pretty good one.
Yeah, I liked it. Oh my god, my cat is jumping and ruining everything. I'm so sorry.
Cats, is that James Corden? Is he fucking with your mic setup?
You mean Rebel Wilson? Yes, he
is. Yeah, the Rebel Wilson unzipping herself part really will just live rent-free in my mind.
Twice? Yeah. Twice.
I saw that movie in th- theaters.
Ooh,
a fun. Packed theater, actually.
Fine. My condolences.
No, I like that's the experience I wanted. I am jealous.
Honestly, it was a good experience.
Yeah. So cats, cool.
Oh yeah, cats.
The cat cast. Well, much like yourself, I've been watching some horror themed stuff. I watched Maniac Cop. Nice. Which was a lot of fun. A great cast. We got Tom Atkins. We have a pretty young Bruce Campbell. And it's about a killer cop. I loved it. It was so silly. Like sometimes it dragged on a little bit, but a lot of those movies from the 80s can. Mm-hmm. Then I watched two movies that weren't horror, but one of them was obviously Many Saints in Newark. I'm going to save my thoughts on this because my friend Colin and I are going to do an episode on it. But I'm just going to completely fanboy for a second. It was really cool being brought back into the world of The Sopranos. Mm-hmm. If you want to look at it critically, you'll have a field day nitpicking things, you know, and when I reviewed it on Letterboxd, I made it pretty clear I'm going to forgo those criticisms because I'm just such a diehard fanboy and I just loved everything they gave me. But like I said, I'll elaborate more on that on the episode. But I also watched Blind Fury with Rucker Hauer for my friend Chris's birthday. Our friends at Everything Action, who we've been featured there before, he did like a little birthday commentary podcast track, and we watched Blind Fury, and it was hysterical. I mean, it's Rucker Hauer playing a blind swordsman. Like, I loved it. Like, it was funny as fuck. But then I watched Scream 3, which we'll get into. And then I watched The Brood by Cronenberg. Never seen The Brood, always been on my list, and it's on the Criterion channel. And I really enjoyed it. I didn't know what to expect going into it. It was shocking. It was disturbing for sure. And I think that was like a couple movies into his filmography. And I think he really nailed it with the psychological horror and the body horror. And that comes into play like more at the end anyway. But I thought it was pretty cool. I don't know if you guys ever saw it, but
yeah, that was the first movie I watched when I got Criterion Channel.
Nice. Going right to the good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty good. It's very Cronenberg in like a good way.
It is very Cronenberg, yes. And then the final one I watched was Prom Night 2. So I haven't seen the first one.
What?
Well, I'll explain. So my friend was like, so we have a couple choices to do a little movie night, and it was between that or Exorcist 3, and I was like, well, we're watching it like we have a watch party for it, so I said, let's do Prom Night 2. And with a lot of these horror sequels, especially the ones in the 80s, you don't really need to. It's good to watch them in order, but you can watch them out of order unless it is like very plot driven. Mm-hmm. But obviously, like, the only similarity in this of the first one is the name of the high school. Mm-hmm. Everything else is different. So it was good because like it was a slasher that kind of came off a little bit like a spoof movie, which very relevant for today's topic. Mm-hmm. But it very clearly was a love letter to Carrie and mm-hmm. other movies in that genre. But it was really interesting. I had a pretty good time with it. There was a lot more death and sex parts in it than I thought there were going to be. But I guess with prom in the title, I'm not that shocked.
Yeah.
Anyway.
What to expect.
Yeah. So that's what I watched recently. How about you, Blake?
I actually have not watched a ton of movies recently all the way through. And usually when I don't watch something all the way through, I don't like log it on Letterboxd or anything. But I've just kind of been like here and there putting on like AMC's doing their like fear fest or whatever they call it. And so I've watched like Halloween 4 and like Fright Night, like just random stuff, bits and pieces. And other than that, I watched Midnight Mass recently, which was fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely highly recommend it. It's technically not a movie, but it basically is. And I love Mike Flanagan. So if you like Mike Flanagan, you'll like it. But a lot of people have been kind of critical of the amount of monologues in it. And there are that's a pretty fair criticism because half the show is monologues, but it's worth it. I promise.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of expect a show called Midnight Mass to be very dialogue centric, you know?
Yeah, it's a kind of like a heavy show. I don't know how else to put it, where like it takes itself very seriously. So like, if that's not the kind of like horror that you like, you're not gonna like it.
Yeah, I definitely got that vibe because I started it too, but I only watched the first episode. I definitely caught that vibe for mm-hmm. sure. Yeah, I'm excited to continue it though.
Yeah, it's great. And it's nice and short too. That's what I like about it.
Yeah, like 7 episodes, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's nothing. It's nothing.
Nothing.
Anyway, so that's the end of the podcast. Have a good
one. See ya. Have a good night.
So let's get into Scream. Scream is very interesting because it decides that it's going to be a horror movie, but it's going to be meta as fuck. And it's going to be a commentary on the genre itself. And I think that when I first experienced that, it was interesting because I didn't know how to feel necessarily. Like in the first movie, it's definitely a thing. But as you go throughout the series, it's more and more satirically centric to the point where, like, in the fourth one, it's just no holds barred. It's like movie within a movie within a movie within a movie. But that's what I really love about it. And I think that kind of brilliance, well, I mean, first of all, which came from Wes Craven. Fucking my genius.
Boy.
The boy Wesley Earl Craven. I only know that whole name because I have it tattooed on my ass.
Oh my god.
But obviously, you know him from Nightmare on Elm Street and other good stuff, but he was responsible for Scream. And I think when I first watched it a long time ago, I didn't realize that because I think I saw the first one when I was like 17 or something. And then I, like, when I watched the second, I was like, oh, yeah, shit, this is Wes Craven. And then up until the fourth one, which I think that might have been his last movie.
It was his last movie.
Yeah, it was his last movie.
Shut your mouth. Yeah. It's so sad.
it is, yeah. And it was a lot of fun. I didn't log it yet, but I really enjoyed the fourth one.
Oh, I'm glad. Yeah. I think it's stupid good fun.
Yeah, I thought I was gonna, and that's the thing too, is like, whenever I watch a lot of these horror sequels, I expect like the first one's usually gonna be bomb, second one's gonna be probably all right. Then once you get into the third and fourth ones, it depends on the series you're talking about, you know, unless you're Halloween, right? Which is just always a good time. But with this, I didn't know what to expect. And with each one, I was like, wow, I was expecting it to like rank it lower and lower. I was like, no, like it's still good quality. Mm-hmm. I thought it was going to be complete dog shit by the third one, but it was good still all the way through. Yeah, I'd say three is probably only, like my least favorite, but yeah.
It's one of the only slasher franchises that's pretty consistent.
Yeah, I would say so.
Yeah. And it's funny because I don't know like the origins of Scream or in general, but it almost seems like it was a back burner idea that ended up blowing up. Like, I don't know if that's true, but it just seems like, especially with his body of work, you would have expected like, all right, you know, I'll do this one Scream movie and maybe people will like it. And then it just turned out to be like this phenomenon. But since you said you know the origin, Laney.
Well, I at least know what it's based off of.
Okay.
It's based off the Gainesville Ripper. Danny Rollins, I believe is his name. He's a real fucked up son of a bitch. his murder scenes were very, very gruesome, laid out specifically for like cops to find like these women in really terrible ways. And so it's loosely based off of that. And that's basically all I know. But yeah, I think that's really fun looking at all the violence of it. I'm like, oh yeah, pretty comparable of real life.
See, yeah, I didn't even know it was based on something.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was just like an idea. But yeah, that, I mean, that makes sense. And you actually touched on something that I really respect about the series is its use of framing. Mm-hmm. And like, I mean that figuratively and literally, mm-hmm. because you'll see like, and we'll skip around here. I don't want to like, obviously we don't have a fucking structure on the show, so like whatever, but like in the fourth one, for example, there's like towards the end of it, you find out that the girl Jill was behind all the murders, and when she goes to frame the scene, the murder scene, and make her the victim, it was really interesting, because I've obviously seen movies do that, you know, they'll show you how somebody sets up the scene, frames the murder. I also watch a lot of Columbo, so but I think the way they did it in that is brilliant, because it comes from the perspective of somebody who's just fucking insane, but like you didn't really know, and that twist comes in, and there were definitely like, and the thing with these movies too is you kind of have a good idea of who ends up behind the killings, but even if you do, there's always several twists that follow it. Mm-hmm. And I think like especially in the fourth one, like when Jill then turns around and stabs Charlie. Mm-hmm. Obviously spoilers for all of this, but
yeah.
Right. Just revealing the end part of the last movie.
Listen, you've had 10 years to watch all the movies.
Yeah. You know what? Fuck you. You had 10 years.
I saw that movie in theater. Scream 4 is the only one I was able to see in theaters. And my jaw was on the floor watching that. I was like, God, this bitch is fucked up. It's like, it's really intense. Like her throwing herself on that fucking table and just like all of it, like stabbing herself in the shoulder. It's brutal.
And especially considering, so Jill's whole primal directive basically was, oh, I want to be the star of the story. We're gonna end your, which is hysterical because it's another commentary on remakes and reboots. We're gonna end. She's having that conversation with Sydney, and she's like, "We're gonna end your story. Your story's done. It's time for my story." and it was like so on the nose, and I loved it. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking like, well, if you twist that perspective, haven't you noticed your cousin went through a whole hell of a lot? Like, but you're so hell bent, and of course it was also a commentary on the newer generation, mm-hmm. and how everyone wants to just get internet famous and live vicariously through those personas that were created. So
it's, very quickly getting fame.
Right. So there's so many layers to it that like you would think a movie series like Scream wouldn't be so deep, but like each movie, like you just peel it back and there's more and more to it. But on the surface level, it's still an enjoyable slasher. Mm-hmm. And that's the most important part, is like, it's kind of hard, to marry the idea of serious and silly and then add social commentary onto it. Mm-hmm. But they just find like this perfect balance of it all. And I really respect the series for that.
And you mentioned that you said that Scream 3 is your least favorite, right?
I would say so, like really thinking about it.
It's a different writer is why.
Oh.
That's the only one with a different writer, which is
that's
why
interesting.
Mm-hmm, I feel like people usually rank it as one of their like the lower of the three, and then four now that that's happened.
All right, Aaron Kruger. What kind of shit
I assumed
have you
it
done?
Was just because of the bangs, but I guess
Her little mini baby bangs.
Yeah, that's the best hairstyle in the entire franchise.
Oh, hell yeah.
It's so bad. It's so distracting. It makes her forehead look so big. Other than that, she looks banging, but God, girl.
But I will say, like, Scream 3 is really the one that you start to... Because, like, obviously, you get a decent amount of story from the first two. Mm-hmm. But the third one is when you really start to figure out like, oh, fuck, this goes deeper than you thought. Cause then, you find out that Sydney's mom, Maureen, was an actress, and she ended up getting abused and raped, unfortunately, mm-hmm. when she moved to Hollywood. And then she tried to blacklist the industry. And then she got kicked out. She got blacklisted. I mean, cause she tried to expose the industry, and mm-hmm. she got kicked out of Hollywood and whatever. So yeah, it really it's that, and see that plot twist, I guess I saw that it could have been Roman, right, the director of Stab 3.
I
could see it was him, but I like the actual motivation was interesting, because it's like, oh, you were not wanted by your mother, you were basically the unwanted child, and you tried to reconnect with her and she didn't want any part of you, which is interesting because, like, obviously he's a piece of shit murderer. Yeah. but if you do a deep dive into why he did what he did, you're like, so you had a pretty fucked life, I guess, right? Mm-hmm. Like, but it's hard to sympathize because, you know, he's killing everyone.
That's why I do appreciate that ending where she's like, she like stabs him and she like, they're holding hands, and it's like a moment that they have before she recognizes that, like, it was fucked up.
Yeah.
It was not okay.
Yeah.
And so I appreciate that moment, because it's like, yeah, they all had motivations, whether they be more justified or than others, but yeah. Like, she knew, she felt it, she understood, and I always appreciated that moment.
I think the way they did it was pretty great. And I had mentioned Roman was the director of Stab 3, so in these movies there's so like the murders of Woodsboro happen in the first one, then Gail Weathers, who's a reporter played by Courtney Cox, ends up writing a book about those murders, which then gets adapted into a movie series called Stab, which fits alongside the rest of the movies in the series. So like, within each movie they're either filming it, they're talking about it, or and like, that's another level of meta that they're adding into the mix. So
I also love that, like, in the first one she's like, they'd probably get God, what's her name? Tori Spelling to play me. And then, like, that's who they got is, I think, is so funny.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's a lot of cool callbacks in the movie. Like in the first Scream, opens with Drew Barrymore's character. She's on the phone with Ghostface, and then she ends up dying. And then, like, in the he's playing the horror trivia game with her. And then it's like all the way to the fourth one, Charlie sets up the scene where he's like strapped to the chair, and what's her name? Kirby. Yeah.
How could you forget?
Great name, by the way.
The best name.
Yeah.
The best name.
and she's on the phone with Ghostface, and he's playing the game with her again. And I just like, there's such a great level of consistency with their callbacks.
It's movies. Great. Did you know that Drew Barrymore was actually supposed to be Sidney Prescott?
I could see that from a studio perspective. Oh, it was her decision to.
Yeah, she backed out. She didn't want to really be the star in the horror movie, and so she was like, "I'll like be the first one killed." And they were like, "All right, cool," and they rolled with it. As far as I've read, but yeah.
Well,
so
shit. She was supposed to have it. But Neve Campbell, like, I can't even imagine someone else in that role now.
You know, it's Neve Campbell forever. She's the greatest. She's the best final girl, in my opinion. I fucking love her.
I will also say that it took me until not that long ago. I think Blake, it was at your house that I discovered that's Drew Barrymore in the poster.
Oh yeah, well, I have that gigantic poster.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and I of course it makes sense, but I did not even put two and two together, because they do a little bit of editing to it. It's not straight up discernible. So like.
No, I remember staring at the VHS covers and being like, I think that's Drew Barrymore.
Is that her?
Because I was fucking obsessed. You said you saw it when you were 17. I saw it when I was like 8.
Yeah. So you were just studying the
VHS. Yeah, no, I was like obsessed. I was nipples deep in this shit. I was so into it. And he was like, the Scream was the reason I was like, oh, I need to like fall, like look into more Wes Craven stuff, because he's great. So. Ishban, he's a good one.
He is a good one. I wish he was around. What do you think he would make right now if he had an unlimited budget? What do you think he'd make right now?
I would hope that he would be doing Scream 5. That's what I'm the most sad about and skeptical about with Scream 5.
Who is directing Scream 5?
I have no idea.
Good question. Let me look it up.
Yeah, I was gonna say, let's find that out real quick.
I just knew it wasn't Wes Craven, so I was like, fuck it.
It is. It has two directors on IMDb. Let's see. I don't know how to
pronounce this. Oh, a two director joint. Let's go. Let's fucking go.
It's one guy named Matt Beninelli Olpin. Oh, he directed Ready or Not, which was a great movie. And the other guy is named Tyler Gillett. And
Perry?
They co-directed Ready or Not.
Okay.
Which was a pretty good movie. So that's pretty much the biggest thing that he has, like both of them have to their credit.
So
the main three are coming back though, right? That's what I heard.
Yes.
Yeah, it's got like a lot of
yeah
people from the originals.
Definitely got the main three. Yeah. And then whoever they bring back is anyone's guess.
That's exciting.
Matthew Lillard, obviously, because that will work. Which, by the way, just quick side note, him as Stu is just
the two killers in the first are like the absolute best.
Mm-hmm. I was upset I didn't see a Billy and Stu kissing though.
I mean, that's what we all have been waiting for.
Billy and Stu ruled 34.
Oh, it for sure exists.
And they both
definitely exists.
Cuter as they got older. Both handsome boys.
Yeah. It's too bad that it makes no sense for them to be in it again because both of them are like kind of having like resurgences right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be pretty cool, but it would make no sense.
I
would be there for it.
I could totally see based on what you've seen other people do. I could totally see them somehow shoehorning them in just like for a second.
Scream multiverse and they'll come back.
Honestly, yeah. I wonder. So there was how much of a year difference between 4 and 5 is there going to be? Like,
well, 4 came out in 2011.
Yeah. 2011. Okay.
So
it'll be like an 11 year.
Yeah. Difference. 5 comes out next year.
So yeah, 11 year difference.
So I wonder if they're just going to completely kill it after this or if they're just going to keep opening it up.
I think it will depend on how well it does.
Depend on sales, yeah.
That's true, yeah.
I think so, yeah. It'll be interesting to see, like, talking to my grandkids and they're watching Scream 12.
Oh my God. I remember when this one first came out.
Yeah.
I mean, there are people old enough now that their grandkids are going to see new Halloween movies in theaters. Yep. So.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Not impossible.
Yep.
Yeah. So the rest of the podcast is just going to be a Dewey appreciation thread.
Honestly, though,
I love Dewey.
I love him so fucking much.
Yeah. David Arquette brings such a genuineness to the role.
He's the definition of a goober.
He's a goober.
That man. He's a goober. His stupid fucking mustache, his stupid little limp he gets. Everything about him is amazing.
Oh, yeah, the limp.
The limp. Oh, my God. If I could just give him kisses on the forehead, I would. I love him so much.
Yeah, Dewey has had a fair amount of shit happen to him. Like, he's pretty much been stabbed in, like, every one of the movies. He's also just been heartbroken. But at the same time, he tries to like
a sister.
Yeah, yeah. At the same time, he tries to like exude this confidence that I love.
Yeah.
Such a goober.
That's why I liked it when Gail got fucked up a little bit in the fourth one. I was like, it's about time.
Oh yeah, I thought for a second like that they may have killed her off, but then I realized she's gonna be in this one. They're not doing that.
Well, I saw in the theater, so I was like, am I about ready to walk out of the fucking theater right now? They're gonna kill off Gail fucking Weathers. I was not gonna be okay, but her face. Ooh. I hope it's better this time around.
Yeah, I guess we'll see. I guess it'll be interesting too to see because I know in Scream 401 she survives the attack.
Mm-hmm.
She'll probably end up getting inspiration moving towards her new like fiction novel, and I'm curious to see like what she does as in Scream 5. Like, she'll probably just go back to writing the same stories. Write a Game of Thrones knockoff, you know. Game of Bones. Yeah, the Dewey and Gal marriage though is interesting because I wanted Dewey all to myself.
That's understandable. I did always like their relationship though. And because I mean, I knew them always as together in real life. So I was like, oh, it's cute.
Yeah, it takes me out a little bit, half a star.
So then Scream 4 came and ruined their relationship. No, I don't know. That's just my theory.
Well, it's not a theory, it's a fact.
Is it? You heard it here first. At least that's my headcanon. Scream 4 ruined their relationship.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I feel like that was kind of written on the wall though, because they because of their personalities, how distinct they are, and how Gal is just always about her work and trying to like get the scoop, and yes, she was helping out with the murders, but like Dewey made it abundantly clear like this shit's dangerous, you know. Now and four, he's the sheriff.
Yep.
So he's trying to play everything straight and leave her out of it. Mm-hmm. She's like, lol, nope.
Yeah, she gets so fucking mad that he's like, I'm the sheriff and you're literally not a sheriff. Like, you're not a police officer.
You're not a sheriff, Ma. Yeah, it's like, okay.
You're not.
It's like, yeah, we know you have good intentions. She's been wrapped in it since the beginning, but like.
I would be a little salty too. I think I would be a little Gail Weathers in that situation.
A little Gail.
Yeah. I'd be like, what the fuck, dude?
Excuse me. I want to get killed.
Yeah.
Me.
That's like the biggest dream though, is to play a fucking, like, someone getting murdered in a Scream movie. It's like been the dream since I was little.
Well, when they inevitably make 10 more. My throat goes
face.
And then you'll keep the fake neck they give you, like like Jonah Hill did from Superbad.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Like, did you know that, by the way? That in Superbad, when it's in the dream scenario and he gets his neck sliced open, he has the fucking prosthetics for that.
That's pretty cool. I would keep as much as I could if I was in a movie.
Oh, me too. Yeah.
I'd steal everything.
I would too. Like in Scream 3 when what's her fuck? Emily Mortimer? Is that her name? Whatever her name is. She's like stealing all the props.
I think it's Mortimer, yeah.
I would steal the props too. Mm-hmm. I feel that.
Speaking of three, when they pop in the tape of Jamie Kennedy, speaking after he dies, I was like, oh, that's weird.
Yeah.
I was so glad he made a cameo in it though.
Yeah, honestly, I'm like, fuck it. You should have lived, god damn it. I'll never get over Andy's death.
Yeah, honestly, that one didn't that happen like in the news van or something?
Yep.
That one was sad because like he was perfect comedic relief.
Yeah, he was. Yeah,
and you just get
that was an upsetting there. One.
Yeah, but it's cool too
by because... Aunt Jackie from Roseanne.
true. And Scream's another thing too, where it's like it taught me don't ever get attached to main characters.
Oh yeah,
which is cool. Like they were always willing to take risks like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's really cool in a movie that could have a lot at stake plot wise.
Yeah,
they're like, fuck it, we're killing main characters. I also love in 3 that Patrick Warburton was in it.
Yep.
I got a
security guard, right?
I got a huge kick out of that. I was like, that is Patrick Warburton. And it took me a second.
Throughout these movies, there's so many good people that come in and just get murdered, and it's wonderful.
It's honestly just a privilege.
It really is, like Rose McGowan, Sarah Michelle Gellar. That dude is pretty great.
Jerry O'Connell, Jada Pinkett.
Yeah, Jada Pinkett Smith. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which, by the way, the opening of 2 is probably one of the coolest kills in a horror
which
movie.
One the one in the theater or the in one the, in
when
the
it, yeah when it opens up in the movie theater
yeah it's cool
mm-hmm. I love that one because yeah, that's like so that's good. Honestly a fucking real scenario like that could happen.
I could easily happen.
Could happen.
Yeah, it's a good one.
But yeah,
yeah,
I think sure. That's one of the appeals of the Scream movies too. They're not like Friday the 13th or like Nightmare on Elm Street where it's so like out of the realm of possibility. Like the Scream movies never go into the supernatural territory. Mm-mm. Really.
As I got older, I started to respect that more.
Mm-hmm.
Because the unsettling nature of, hey, this could happen,
mm-hmm.
does it for me more.
Oh, yeah.
You know, oh, yeah. I'm not saying anything paranormal would take me out of it, but it's just not what the movie is.
Yeah, it's not time and place for that.
It works.
I wouldn't be surprised if that's because Wes Craven kind of like watched the Nightmare franchise like die out.
Yeah.
And he kind of just wanted to do something different. Because mm-hmm. I was looking at it too, and New Nightmare came out 2 years before the first Scream.
Mm-hmm.
And like you could see a lot of his ideas from New Nightmare like cross over into like Scream and like the later movies, like with like the movie in a movie stuff and mm-hmm. like these things that take place on like movie sets. It all kind of, the seed is kind of planted in that movie, which I don't think had very good like reception when it came out. So I guess maybe he wanted to like try it again.
What if we kissed in the Woodsboro set from Scream 3?
What if we kissed anywhere? anywhere in the Scream movies.
Yeah.
The other important thing is that Wes Craven made one movie in between New Nightmare and Scream, and it was Vampire in Brooklyn, which stars Eddie Murphy.
Oh my God, you're right.
That the Scream to Norbit timeline.
The pipeline, no! It exists. You can't do this to me!
And it's very short.
Too bad. It's happening. Let's fucking go.
Oh, fuck. I hate that.
No, I forgot he did Vampire in Brooklyn. Yeah, holy shit.
It was the year before Scream came out.
Oh, my God.
What a genius.
I truly think so, though. Like, I think he's very good at what he does.
Oh, yeah,
I also love sure. The whole like Scream movie happens and then the movies based on that happens. And then, but it's also based on real killings. Like it's extra meta.
Yeah.
It has the extra layer of it.
So many layers.
It's also really funny to think that they like Scream is such a like meta, like satire of horror movies. And then they made Scary Movie, which was a parody of horror movies.
Yes.
It's very weird.
Really funny about that though is the original name for Scream was going to be Scary Movie.
I could
see wow.
That. Yeah. That would have worked.
Yeah.
But then our good old friend Harvey Weinstein was like, no, Scream.
Wow, you mean good. Harvey Weinstein did a bad thing?
He did one decent you thing in his whole bad. Life.
Good. Yeah, but anyway, back to Norbit.
I really think that linking of the universes will keep me up at night.
I'm just saying it's there.
I can't wait to hear the theories that you come up with because of this bullshit.
the next time we record, I'm gonna have a like behind me the red string like yeah! Eddie Murphy connected to every movie ever made.
Oh my God,
no. How you two win. So what we're trying to say is the Scream series sucks.
Yeah, it's the worst. What did you think of the first like 10 minutes of the fourth movie?
Oh my God. Yeah, that was ridiculous. I think that that was like beyond ridiculous.
Because
I was about to watch it and Laynee had told me that it's hysterical. I'm like, all right, it's probably pretty good. And it's just like, kill, and then it's the movie, kill, it's the movie, kill, it's the movie. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Sorry, my mic decided to come out of my stand.
Nice.
I think it didn't want me to talk about movies anymore.
Yeah, it gave up. You do this like, too often.
It was just like, dude, kill me, take me out.
Should we talk about our predictions for the new one? Like, what do we think it's going to be?
What we think it's going to be about?
Yeah.
Sure.
What it'll be about? What is? Because like, it's kind of strange that they're doing the Halloween thing where it's just called Scream. It's not called Scream 5.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that that does not, like, I hope that doesn't have any, like, meaning of what the movie's going to be about. I really hope it doesn't, like, start over or whatever.
Oh, yeah. I don't know.
Like, I like the Scream canon. I don't want them to try and, like, retroactively, like, take things out.
Yeah, for sure. Like, that, especially that first one is, like, it's golden. It's so good.
Yeah, the only way I could see that happening is because in the final movie, comments were made about how, oh, this is the end of your story. We're going to start a new. So like maybe they're going to try to do something somewhere, but I would want them to do something completely different.
Maybe they'll kill off the main three in the beginning. And that'd it's be like a whole new, like, whole holy new Scream shit. Story, like similar to the original, but with like new actors to be like the new Gale and the new Sydney and all that shit. I mean, so, I don't know if I would like that, but
yeah,
I mean, truthfully, that would be very fitting for Scream.
Yes.
Like, it would make a lot of sense. And I would kind of like that. I don't know where they would go after that, but it would be kind of cool.
I think I would just be weeping in the fucking theater. Like, oh, did you do that? Oh, no. And then try to be okay.
I think my prediction is Sarah Michelle Gellar is going to come back and haunt everyone.
And be Buffy.
No. no, I think it may sound a little nutty, but I think Sydney's going to be like in a fucking mental asylum.
I mean, could you?
I think she's she's either going to be or she's going to just isolate. Well, again,
she's Ghostface.
I think. Oh, my God. No, I think that she will be on some medication and she will be like completely disassociated. And they're gonna like try to get her back, like do and Gale, like that more murders are happening, they're gonna try to get her back to help, and there might be like a struggle. I don't know. I feel like that could be a thing they do.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, everyone who's ever been in her life has literally died.
Literally
been
died.
A killer, been literally a killer
died and died in front of her or died to her.
Yeah. Yes. Or has been the one doing all of the murdering. Like,
like how
the
yeah,
only
how much
people in the entire
do?
World she can trust are like Dewey and Gale. She can't trust her fucking family. They're trying to kill her too.
Yeah. Seriously. Yeah. It's stupid fucking psychotic cousin trying to murder her.
Seriously, even a brother you don't know about, like, shit's
and
not
your brother
good for you.
Yeah, it's not good. Yeah, I don't know. I feel like that would probably be my theory on what happens. I mean, as far as the killer, it's, as we've quickly learned, it's anybody's game. Mm-hmm. They're gonna be like, I was your cousin's aunt's dog walker's butcher.
Yeah, like,
and you fucked my husband. It's like, because that's just what the series is, right?
Yeah, like, but I at least in the way that it somewhat did make sense, you know.
Oh yeah, I'm kidding.
They
yeah,
were all but... plausible things, so I hope it doesn't get too far away from that.
No, I mean, I'm curious to know like how that will work though, because they mm-hmm. have pretty much covered. They did everything. Brother, they did cousin, they did friend, they did
boyfriend.
They so like, I wonder where they go from there. Grandfather, like
the Dewey and Gale couple team, they're killing. That'd be fun. She really just loses break with reality.
You think they're gonna stay together in the movie?
I think for the movie possibly, but I could also see like a divorce being in there, because
I think so too. I
guess in my brain, like, Courtney Cox is Gale Weathers and David Arquette is Dewey. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking there could be something like that.
Maybe they could just be divorced in the fifth one, and they like touch on it for a second or whatever. They could be together though.
Yeah,
can't see it going either way.
Divorce, psychiatric ward. Blake, what do you got? Let's add to the list here.
I don't really know, but I'm the big thing that like a lot of people are worried about is obviously that Wes Craven's not involved. Yep. But I hope that they. are smart enough to like see what makes Scream work, which is like the satire and like the social commentary kind of stuff. I hope they don't take that out.
Yeah, for sure. I think they know. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's been 11 years since the last movie and a lot has changed about like horror and like the genre itself, which Scream has always been like the perfect vehicle to like comment on. And so I hope that they recognize that instead of just making like a slasher movie with Ghostface. And like, so we'll see. I have faith because I don't see how anybody could look at the franchise and not see that that's what it's about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
But yeah. I get people that are a little bit like wary of it being a Scream movie without Wes Craven.
Well, and it's also not any, it's not the writer who did 1, 2, and 4 either.
Mm-hmm.
It's the directors who wrote it, I guess.
Oh, so this will be really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's really just as long as they can get like the spirit of Scream, that's the important part. Like that's what I liked about Halloween 2018. I felt like it captured like the spirit of that franchise pretty well. So hopefully they recognize that and go out of their way to like do that. They're clearly going to do as much like fan service as that movie did by like bringing all these people back and everything. So we'll see. I'm hopeful, but you never know.
Yeah, I'm hopeful too. I was hopeful about the new Candyman and I was very disappointed. So
we were talking about that before we started recording, but I haven't seen it yet, but I haven't seen anybody really like enthusiastic about it.
Nope. I have no enthusiasm for it. Zero. I think I hated it more than Sam did. So.
Yeah. I mean, I thought it was fine. You know, I didn't love it. I didn't hate it.
I'm upset. So.
Okay. Well, movies suck. You should have expected this.
That's true. Very true.
That was another one that didn't have a number. It was just Candyman.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what we're doing now.
I guess so.
Which makes absolutely no sense, but
it annoys me.
Yeah. I just helped me categorize it.
I never understand. Just like give it a subtitle. Cause like what I keep saying, like the Halloween series, the current canon of the Halloween series is Halloween Kills.
Yeah. Yeah,
it doesn't make any sense.
It's ridiculous.
Now this one is Scream 2, Scream 3, Scream 4, Scream.
Scream. Like, what?
Have you seen Scream? No. Scream.
Scream from 1996 or Scream from 2022? Like, really? We're going to have to play that game?
Yeah.
It's just, like, silly to me. I don't understand it. I guess, like, it's kind of like a marketing thing, but I don't know. It just seems dumb.
If they were remakes, I would understand, but they're not. So, well, at least Halloween wasn't. So, whatever.
It all sucks.
Yeah, everyone sucks.
Courtney Cox is not going to do this movie anymore. It's just going to be a Friends reboot.
Okay.
Honestly, what if the new Scream was just them killing off the cast of Friends?
I'd love that.
I would be really into that, honestly. Especially with all the little like friends thrown in there throughout the movies. Like there's a Jennifer Aniston like remark and a David Swimmer remark, and so it's like super funny. I would love that.
So cool. We just found the plot of Scream
5. I think we just figured it out.
Cool. I can't believe we've accidentally stumbled upon it. So
Matthew Perry will die first.
Sydney is in a mental hospital and she imagines the entire Friends series.
No one told me life is gonna be this way. She bangs her head against the wall and pops another Vicodin.
It's just like stabbing to the pep, 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 like so good.
So where would you guys personally rank the movies in your opinion if you had to do like a 1 through 4?
I'd probably do them in order and just switch 3 and 4. So I'd just go Scream, Scream 2, Scream 4, Scream 3.
I'd probably do the same thing.
Mine would go in order.
I'd probably do the same thing.
Like two. Mine would go in complete order. I have such nostalgia for those main, like those first three.
Yeah, for sure.
And I would say though, the gap between like the top and the bottom of this list is pretty small because I do like all of the movies.
Very
yeah. for sure. I think one of my favorite characters is actually Mickey. Because
Timothy Oliphant.
First of all, I love Timothy Oliphant.
He's the best.
He is one of my favorite actors.
He's amazing and he's cute.
Pick anything he's done. He was even good in the Crazies remake.
Mm-hmm.
He was even good in Santa Clarita Diet.
Oh my god, I love that show. Yeah.
Yeah, that got canceled early. Like,
upsets me because I could stare at the two of them for the rest of my life, and I thought they had great chemistry.
I did too. I thought that we were gonna see more, but
bullshit. Netflix sucks.
Yeah. But I really, really enjoyed Mickey because he was not only funny and a sociopath,
yeah,
but he also he wanted to get caught.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Like, I think that was interesting. Like, I know that there's sort of this theme where it's like, oh, well, I'm victim. But he was straight up just like, no, I'm killer. Mm-hmm. That's how I want people to remember me.
And then I'm going to blame the movies, which is such a funny because I did rewatch Scream 2 recently, and I rewatched Scream 1 and 2 recently. And I was like, wow, this argument still kind of could be made today because everyone's stupid. But it's funny how that hasn't changed.
And that's just another layer.
Yep.
Of commentary.
Uh-huh.
Oh, no, it's the bad movie that made me do it.
It's the movies that are bad.
Yeah.
I was thinking about that, too. Like, there's so many things throughout the whole franchise that are just as relevant now,
mm-hmm,
that I hope they, touch on again, you know?
Yep. Because you can easily go back and revisit them because they're still here.
Especially now, they have even more to work with.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, it will be very interesting to see all the themes and messages.
Yeah, because I feel like at the very heart of Scream, the big commentary is a lot about people kind of having main character syndrome, and everybody thinks that everything is about them all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of follows through all of the killers through the entire franchise. And mm-hmm, I feel like that's more relevant than ever now. So I hope that they touch on that.
Yeah,
I think so.
That's a good point. Yeah.
So what if there's no ghost face in this and it's just an octopus?
Just a big killer. Character study on Sydney Prescott, because she's has to be a little crazy at this point.
I'm telling you, she might not be in a ward, but she's definitely taking medication. She definitely can't sleep. If she's functioning in Scream 5 at all, I'm going to be shocked.
Do you think that'll be kind of how they did it with God, what's her name? Lori from Halloween. How she's extra paranoid. Because they kind of did that with Scream 3.
That's true. I think they would do it in a way where it's unique to the franchise. I don't think, because she's also been through a lot, but I do believe that she has a certain strength to her character,
mm-hmm,
and her direct involvement in it all might help her. But I think she will probably be close to that level, or again, she'll be in a fucking ward. It's somewhere in between. She's either ward, or, she's taking something. She gotta be taking something.
I mean, she's gotta be self-medicated.
Yeah, she's gotta be doing something. Yeah. She's either popping pills, she's becoming an alcoholic.
Yeah, she's just deep into her fucking alcohol addiction.
Yeah, she's literally she's doing something, right?
She grew up to be me.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. And is there, I know it's 2022, but do we know specifically when it's coming out?
I'm not sure.
Is it beginning of the year?
I assume when the trailer comes out, it'll have
to let us know. Yeah. Yeah. It's exciting stuff.
Yeah. Which also, side note, since we were kind of talking about where she's going to be and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
If you like all of the ideas of final girls, affected by things that happen to them, I just recently read a book called Final Girl Support Group by Grady Hendrix. Mm-hmm. And it's all about that.
That's cool.
All of the characters are very thinly veiled versions of Lori from Halloween and and Sydney from Scream. So
awesome.
Definitely highly recommend that book.
That's awesome.
I think that my heart goes out to this fucking poor girl. She needs a break. I hope she gets a little bit of relief before the killing starts.
Yeah. Yeah. I do think seriously. She's one of the best final girls. She's been through the most.
Seriously, I love her. She's great in every way. She's like a little sassy. She fights back like a beast. She's she keeps coming back. She's awesome. I love her.
Yep.
For she's got sure. big, beautiful teeth. She's great. Scream was like a weird bi awakening for me, so I have a lot of mixed feelings with Scream in general. Like, everyone is so bangable, Jesus.
It's definitely that is true, right?
Like it's all, they've all consistently had a pretty attractive cast. Like,
yeah, they're all so beautiful.
Yeah, that's funny. I didn't even really think about that.
But especially the first one, you give me fucking Skeet Skeet and Rose McGowan. Oh my god. Oh.
Yeah.
That's what dreams are made of.
Yeah. That it's one of those things where after the fact, I'll appreciate that more. When I'm watching it, it's like, especially like when you start them, like, oh yeah, all right. It's kind of like, it's like typical. They're younger, they're more attractive, and then you're like, wait, I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Holy shit. I don't want to know. Then I watch movies like IBS where the character's like fat and gross and wears underwear the whole time. And anyway, you
know,
so
there's something appealing about that too, you know?
Yeah, oh, of course. So I actually just got a leaked cast listing for Scream 5.
Oh shit.
So we have Tom Cruise, Mike Tyson, Ice Sam? Cube, Ice T, Eddie Murphy
in four different roles.
Eddie Murphy in four different roles.
Who will find you?
John Goodman. House. Can you imagine if John Goodman was Ghostface in this one? And they just, and he takes the mask off at the end. Like, here, I'm gonna paint the scene right now. Sydney is in her house, and it's the final face off between her and Ghostface. There's just broken mirrors and glass everywhere. She's trying to like grab a knife, but he's kicking away. And finally, he just reveals himself as John Goodman. And she's like, who are you? And he's just like, I will show you the life of the mind. And then just stabs her in the fucking throat. And then,
all right, here's my dream actor scenario for Scream 5. So it's the end of the movie. She thinks that she's beaten Ghostface. But she turns a corner and he's standing there and he slowly lifts his mask off and he and he just goes and it's Seth Rogen.
I that's gonna happen now. That's gonna fucking happen.
Oh, we have that's to will it scenario. Into the universe so what happens.
It's totally a thing. If not, then it's gonna open with like another stab movie and he's gonna be the killer in it. Like, cut, I don't want to fucking do this. The costume's too hot. I'm taking the fucking
I just think it's time for a Jewish ghost face.
But he also he doesn't use the voice changer, it's just his fucking Seth Rogen voice.
I'm going to haunt you.
I'm going to gut you like a fish, just put his Seth Rogen. And then he laughs after.
We need to like get this to be a thing. We need to kickstart this idea. Seth Rogen needs to be
Scream.
Seth Rogen's Scream. Let's make it happen.
Oh, you know Stu's house from the first Scream? I guess you can get married there. Which I didn't know was a dream of mine until I heard that.
You pay extra for the murder?
Yeah, I would just have like Rose McGowan's hanging body out of the fucking
the door,
the garage door. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I just think that's really fun. It's so fucking iconic. It's rad.
That is actually really cool.
They used to do like sleepovers there where you'd watch the movie in the Scream house, and I was like, why don't I live in California? It's like the only time I've wanted to.
Yeah, I was going to ask because I do know that that is a thing you can do. But where exactly is the house located?
It's like somewhere in California. I can't remember. Yeah. It's a beautiful house. They're probably making so much money.
Probably.
Off that
a lot of those people make money off houses. I think who else does it? It's a couple like big noteworthy houses that they just like let people.
Well, I can tell you for sure because I've been there that the people who own the Goonies house, you're not even like allowed near the property.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which I don't like. Why did you buy the Goonies house then?
What were you expecting?
Live somewhere else.
It's so stupid. What were you
expecting? I'd rather see them profiting off of it.
Yeah, me too. Right.
Yeah, it's
really then you weird. Can make good money, you dumb shits.
Yeah, I don't know why. It's like, why did you? I don't understand. Did you not know that you bought the Goonies house? Like,
yeah, like if I bought a house from a movie,
that'd be pretty funny.
That'd be really funny.
It's like the Goonies.
Wouldn't it cost more money though?
Probably,
right?
Well, it depends. It depends on the state of the property and like who actually owned it. And because I mean, obviously, yeah, like the appraisal value goes up because it was like a historic location, but who knows like how much that was really marked up. But all right, so killer ideas. Gary Busey, right?
Too scary.
Too scary. All right, Jake Busey.
Even scarier.
Jake Busey as the friend who acts innocent, but then is in cahoots with his father, Gary Busey. And that gets revealed at the end.
What if it's Eddie Murphy as Ghostface?
Eddie Murphy.
The pipeline's there.
Exactly.
We have a direct.
That's what we know.
Eddie Murphy.
The second you said Tom Cruise, though, Sam, my heart like literally hit my vagina. I was like, oh my fucking God, no.
And he's the first death. He dies in the first 2 minutes. It's fine. Yeah, I really want Chris Rock to take a stab at Scream.
He did it with Saw.
He did do it with Saw. I still never saw Spiral.
Wasn't good, but he did it. Good.
Yeah, I unapologetically love the entire Saw series, but I'm sure that I wouldn't love that one.
Nah, it was not great.
I still have to see it.
Well, because I even like Jigsaw. Like I thought it was fine.
I still have to see that. I'm very behind on the Saw times right now.
Yeah, I thought Jigsaw was fine. But yeah, Spiral, I don't know. I wasn't in a rush to see it. Like, yeah. Anyway, Seth Rogen. I really need this to happen.
He's going to be Donkey Kong, so why the fuck not Ghostface, right?
Oh yeah, I guess we haven't really done an episode since the hysterical Mario announcement.
We don't need to add it to the Scream one. I feel like that's a disservice to movies and to Scream.
Yeah, we should have like an entire 40 minutes where we just talk about the Mario cast.
I agree.
But with that being said, I did hear James Corden's going to be the killer in Scream 5. Oh, you've been killing, what in it?
I will sue every person in America if that happens.
I will walk out of the theater.
I will find James Corden and I will stab him myself.
Fair enough.
Do a service to all of America.
All right. Well, Scream 6, I'm thinking we'll just have.
Well, we need to write Scream 6. We need to write it.
I think we need to write Scream 6.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I heard they were like.
I think we just did write Scream 6.
I mean, we have many, many good ideas.
Yeah, honest. I'm going to create an account on backstage.com and enlist actors. To... You'll star alongside Seth Rogen. It'll be fun.
Well, no, I think what we need if we make Seth Rogen Ghostface is we need all of the cast of Superbad in there and they get killed off.
That'd be pretty good. Yeah.
Have you guys heard of Ghostface? Shut the fuck up, Fogel. He doesn't exist.
Oh, man. Oh, my God. That would be beautiful.
So, in summation, Scream 1, bad. Scream 2, worse. What about Neil Prescott, huh? I mean, yeah.
Where did he fall off the planet? He in Scream 3 pretends to care for 1 second.
Where'd he fit into all this, huh?
Yeah. Who the fuck does he think he is? I mean, I'm sure he has a lot of trauma being like taken over by two teenagers and like taken hostage. But I feel like
it's all his fault.
He's not a very supportive dad.
It's all Maureen's fault. It's fine.
It's truly, truly all that bitch's fault. Fucking whore. Nah, never. You've seen that guy, right? Did you want to fuck him? I would much rather fuck Cotton Weary. Thank you.
You know what? Yeah. I same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't really blame her.
I'd rather fuck Principal Henry.
Oh my God. Henry Winkler. That's like him getting murdered will always just kind of slightly break my heart because I love him so much.
You notice when he opens the closet, you see a Fonzie jacket.
There's so many good things. Little Wes Craven being the janitor looking like Freddy Krueger.
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah. There's a lot of fun.
The hell you call me?
there's a lot of fun. So I'm curious, like, so there's Scream 1-4.
Mm-hmm. I've brought a guest. There's a guest.
Oh, that's real Dewey.
It's Dewey.
Oh my God, that's the real Dewey.
Wait, is Dewey from Scream namesake or yes. just really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hell yeah! It's actual Dewey.
He hasn't made an appearance in a while, but I figured the Scream episode was the one.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, you need to get him a little sheriff's hat and a mustache for Halloween.
You want to know what's really funny is we're trying to, and because of like everything going on in the world, it's very difficult to find police costumes.
I bet.
Yeah.
Well, eventually that needs to happen.
We've been like,
amazing.
Why can't we find one? And then we're like, oh, right.
You should get another one and name it Gal, and then you could put her in really, really hideous, vibrant like suits,
and,
the skirt
and
suits.
The bangs.
Yeah. Yeah. Give her a little mini baby bangs.
I think that'd be animal abuse.
I think it would too. He's so cute.
Look at little Dewey about to fuck shit up.
Fucking Dewey.
Dewey, what do you have to say about the podcast? Wow, that's fucked up, dude.
Does he have a personality like Dewey? Because that would be even better.
He might be dumber, actually.
I somehow don't believe that.
Yeah, I don't think that's possible.
I don't think that's true. what I was going to ask, though, is so they did Scream 1-4. They're doing a fifth one. Did they ever do any sort of maybe like direct to DVD thing or like some sort of other iteration in the series? Or it's just been 1-4?
Not that I know of.
It's just been 1-4. Okay. I didn't know if they had any like bootleg version.
Weird
like Scream 1.5. Like.
Yeah, no, not that I'm aware of. No.
Okay. Interesting. I wonder, so they didn't do anything else, like maybe like a comic or something? Or
I don't know. Not that I've ever heard of, no.
I'm curious because like Scream has really grown in popularity. So I am surprised that they haven't done like other small things with it.
Yeah, it's... Well, and I was talking to Steven about this when I was watching Scream and fangirling like I do. And I was like, it's so cool that he came in the 90s when like everyone thought horror was over and stale, and he made a new horror icon. Like he made a new monster, essentially.
Yeah.
That's just as known as Freddy Krueger or Michael Myers or Jason.
Oh, yeah.
That shit's tight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Put on them. That's all I gotta say.
It is really cool to think about that because 90s going into early 2000s horror is a very interesting era the genre for many reasons.
Yes, but so. I kind of love it.
Oh,
I think
yeah.
It's nostalgia, but yeah. I kind of love it.
Yeah, that's fair. Like, I do too. But I would say, like, there was some interesting experimentation going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, Craven comes out with Scream and you're like, oh, shit, this is a big baddie, which is cool because there's not much complexity of the character because the whole point of the character is its ambiguity. Mm-hmm. It ends up being somebody that is from her life. It's not like Michael Myers or Jason.
Some rando. Yeah.
So I think to be able to just have a face that iconic that rotates out
mm-hmm.
is impressive.
Yeah.
You know, they don't
it's
need
also
to.
Like the last of the slasher icons, if you really think about it. Like, I can't think of many since 1996 that have like stuck are in that like away. Pantheon of like amazing slasher killers.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really can't think of either.
Like, I guess you could argue like Jigsaw with the little puppet.
Mm-hmm. That's ish,
true. But
yeah.
I wouldn't say it's the same as Ghostface.
Yeah, that's more like traditional slasher.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, for sure.
But I would like to, and I hope that when Scream 5 comes out, it will inspire like a renaissance for the slasher genre, because there's the good part about it is there's endless potential. Like, mm-hmm. It's pretty basic as far as its formula goes. Yeah. All you need is like a good enough story and a good cast, and then just run with it. But mm-hmm. I want to see more slasher.
Oh yeah. Well, and the kills and all of the screams are like just so good. Got to make sure you get all that good gore, those good kills too.
Don't be skimping on the slashy slashy.
Yeah. I expect it.
What do we think some of the kills are going to be in 5?
Oh.
I'm trying to look at the cast and see who I think's going to survive.
Yeah, let me look at the cast. I'm going to look at the cast also.
Like I said, it would be pretty crazy if they kill off the three of them in the beginning.
I'm a little worried it might happen.
It's, you know what it is? Like, it would take some serious balls to do mm-hmm. that. Like, it would immediately put off a huge portion of the audience.
I think I would just be weeping. Kyle Gallagher is in it. Or Gallagher. Oh my God, I love him. Sorry, he's in a lot of shitty horror movies and he's great. He's definitely gonna die.
I think 100% one of the main three is gonna die.
I
don't know which one, but it's one of them.
It's gotta happen, right? I doubt if
it's gotta happen.
If it's Sydney, then I think it wouldn't be till much later in the but I don't think it would be her.
I think it would be somebody important, but not Sydney. Like, I think it would probably be like Gail or Dewey.
Yeah, I think it's got to be.
I think they would kill. I would put money on it that they're going to kill one of those two.
If they're going to kill one of the three, it's definitely one of the two. I mean, I would be very upset if they killed like the best final girl.
Oh, so of all time. So what's interesting is I looked up at the cast and Marley Shelton is back in this one.
Oh, yeah.
The detective who kept hitting on Dewey.
Yeah. The one
which now
she kills Gail. She's going to be Ghostface.
No, I was thinking that I was thinking Dewey and Gail are divorced and they're going to be together.
Ew, don't say that. I would hate that.
Yeah, well, I mean, if Marley Shelton is building this, like...
Which
that's a
Quaid,
pretty strong possibility.
Which Quaid brother is Jack Quaid's kid? Or, yeah, is his dad. Which Quaid, do you know?
I'm pretty sure he's Randy Quaid's son.
Oh, no, that's upsetting.
I think so. Randy Quaid. I hope he's better. No, it's Dennis.
Okay, cool. That's more acceptable.
Oh, okay.
Is Randy, like, still on the run? Like, What's Randy doing?
He lives in a bunker and there was a sex tape that came out with him and his wife, I guess.
Okay, so he's like still on the run.
As far as I know, he's living in a bunker somewhere.
I said Randy Quaid, but I meant Dennis Quaid. I don't know why I was mixing up those names.
Quaid.
It's Quaid, yeah.
Well, it's reasonable.
They do mean very different things.
Yeah. Jack Quaid's cool though. He's in good stuff.
Yeah, there's some faces that I recognize in here.
Yeah, I have to like actually click on the names because I
can't think of who any of them are from, but this girl looks way familiar. Oh yeah, she's in that show I like, Better Things. She's real cute. I bet she'll do a good job.
I like
Jenna Ortega looks familiar.
Mm-hmm.
Dylan Minnette.
Insidious, yeah, like Chapter 2. That's probably where I know her from.
Oh, he was in that movie Prisoners with Joel Noel.
Great movie. He's also the main guy in 13 Reasons Why.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
I wouldn't.
It's don't.
I wouldn't. Don't.
His band's pretty good, though.
Yeah, that's all I can think of when I see his face. So hopefully Scream 5 changes my mind on him.
Yeah, interesting. I wonder what's going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, all I can hope is that it's good and it holds up to the others, because they really didn't go that far downwards in quality or story or anything, in my opinion.
It's just got to be as good as Scream 4.
Yeah, like keep it at that level.
I'll be happy.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be as good as the first one. I don't think there's any doubt about that. But as long as it's not without as good as 4, that's cool.
Yeah. For sure.
It's another 11-year gap, so
mm-hmm.
it's about the same difference.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because like the first three all came out really closely together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was 96, 97, and then 2000.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Oh, how the times have changed.
Yeah, the first one has the anniversary coming up. They're doing like special screenings for it. A lot of people are thinking that at the special screenings is when they'll premiere the trailer.
Oh, if there's one happening in boring old Utah, I'm gonna see if I can go to it. I mean, I doubt it, but we'll see.
Yeah, I'd probably put money on that. That seems reasonable.
What, them releasing the trailer then?
Yeah.
Yeah, it would be pretty cool.
If it's not already out by then.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, those are on Monday, I think, like Sunday and Monday.
Oh, so like right here. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh God, I can't wait for Eddie Murphy's Scream 5.
I am gonna try to avoid trailers as much as possible, like I usually do. Like
mm-hmm.
most of the time, I'll watch like the first like teaser trailer and then kind of avoid them.
Yeah, same actually. I get one to be hyped enough, and then I'm like, okay, I'm hyped.
I don't want it to go too far. Even like the new Halloween, I'm a little nervous that trailer like revealed way too much, because the trailer has a ton of kills in it.
Yeah, they reveal so much shit. It's ridiculous. Yeah, I watched that too, and I was like, oh, did we just watch every kill in the entire movie?
Yeah, it has way too many kills, so I don't want that to happen with this one. So
who the fuck are they hiring to edit their damn trailers?
Pretty much.
Dummies. Yeah. Don't get it. How satisfying is it to watch Jenny McCarthy get murdered, though? Like, now that we know who she is today, isn't it kind of nice?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
You kind of root for her, like, fuck yeah, I got mortared.
Kind of like, okay, get it.
Yeah.
get it. Yeah. So I hope you all learned nothing about this series.
Yeah,
did we learn about the Norbit to Scream pipeline,
which is the only important part of this episode.
I think that's the only thing I took away from this.
Yeah. Well, I will say as a closing thought that this series quickly became one of my all-time favorites. It has everything I want in a horror movie. It's I don't really think there's many off-putting things about the series, if any really. I mean, it just hits every nail for me. It's funny, it's fucked up, it's sadistic, it's twisted, it's meta, it's brilliant. It's I just love it. I feel like the rewatchability on it is just through the roof.
Mm-hmm.
I can always come back and be like, oh yeah, it's fun.
One thing that just popped into my mind that I really appreciate about it is slashers are so known for their like needless nudity. Where is that at in here? Oh, it's not there because it's pointless and it doesn't need to happen. And it's wonderful. And it's like, fuck yes. Like, I like it for that. It's a more modern update of what slashers could and should be.
The show.
Getting that show.
Super bad Scream.
I mean, that's a crossover I could get down with. Norbit. Oh, yeah.
Hell yeah.
That one needs to grow on me a little bit more.
Okay, well, we'll give you a day.
Fuck.
Yeah, so that's been Scream. Anyone have any closing thoughts?
Anyone? Movie's bad.
Well, yeah. Movies suck.
Movies are the worst.
Movies suck. Visit thelobster.com.
Four movies.
Except for these four and Norbit.
It's been a while since we had a lobster.com sponsorship. Yeah. It's good that they're back.
Yeah, the lobster.com was really hit during the pandemic, but they're open and they're back and better than ever. They're thriving. $5, send a crustacean to your family's friends, loved ones, enemies, and you get a personalized message. Don't worry, we take care of them. Anyway, this has been another episode of the Silver Scream Fiends podcast with a spooky episode for our Killer Kino month. And I've been Sam.
I'm Blake.
I'm Laney.
And we have babbled long enough. But you can find Laney at youtube.com/subparcade. Her and Steven play subpar games.
Yeah, no, the games aren't subpar. We are the subpar ones.
Well, it's both.
I mean, watch your mouth. How dare you?
Don't tell Steven. It's brilliant name, though, for sure.
I mean, sometimes he strikes cold.
And you can find Blake and I in a cave sharing the same loaf of bread for a month.
Yep.
Because this is our life now. Anyway, we'll have much more spooky content coming. We'll have our weekly Wednesday watch parties and maybe a spooky giveaway.
Ooh.
We'll see. But until then, we're gonna peace the fuck out. And hopefully we don't get stabbed on the way out of the studio. You know?
Speak for yourself.
Pretty effed up. I hope Ghostface Daddy doesn't come out of the closet
and trip over all of my furniture as I run away from him.
Oh, fuck yeah. God, and I'm going to scream, no, no, please.
No, daddy. Don't kill. But in my mind, I'm screaming, yes, yes, yes.
Yes, Ghostface.
Yes, daddy, yes.
Okay, bye.
Bye. Have a good October, everyone.
Merry Christmas.